We're streaming.
Oh, here you go.
The streaming missed the Whitney Houston? Watching us from afar, it's very hot in the Bay Area, where everyone else is used to heat around the country, and no one here is.
I have favorite.
She's transferred all her knowledge. As I said before, my name is Friends. For those of you who don't know me, I'm a playwright.
I started off in that. I had worked at hedge funds, and I had worked in regular operations and marketing on the ground in Chicago and New York. And then when I moved to the Bay Area, I needed a job. And I started working for a headhunter. A executive search retained consultant in early stage startups. And she had built the entire beginning Facebook engineering team. So she had an interest in what social media was. She didn't know what it was when she built Facebook because it was not yet happening. But this was years after Facebook began. I was the sixth person from my university to be on Facebook. You still had to have a .edu address in order to do that, and it was the Facebook at the time. So I had a little bit of experience in particular. Us as a business, and also how we could attract the to build these products. So it was just kind of a side project while I was researching candidates for her, researching this new experience online. Well, then Facebook went public, and my boss retired, and I had to find a job for myself. I had a 10-month-old child at the time, and had been used to working. So I started working with other people, building on what I had done in New York with regular operations, building on my marketing background and this new social media research that I had been doing and teaching our team about. And I started working with small businesses, largely in the Bay Area, but also now across the country, on content marketing, online presence, SEO, social media. I both teach people how to do it for themselves, largely in small business, also nonprofits and individuals. But also, some people I run their accounts for them. Like, there are several businesses where you see a certain handle on Twitter and it's all me. I like it when it's a little bit me and a lot my client, because they know things best about their business. They are in real time, but we have a combination of it. And I am a contractor for Playwrights Foundation. I help them a couple hours a month on coordinating what our social media strategy is. And so a lot of those at PW Foundation tweets you see are from me, even when I'm abroad during the festival. And we're trying to reach out across the nation through Twitter conversations, the new play hashtag, PW Op, Playwrights Opportunities. We participate in the weekly HowlRound discussion on theater in general, not just for playwriting, but theater in general. That's why I'm here.
Okay. So what's going to happen today is Susan and I are going to have a conversation with each other, because she is the social media expert. I am very good at community building. That's what I do down in Los Angeles with my various academic duties and whatnot. But I also come at this social media stuff as kind of a skeptic. You know, I understand it very well, and I know how to navigate it very well. I don't think that I like it very much. And maybe that will happen by the end of today, unless you convince me otherwise. So we'll chat a bit, and then we'll open it up for questions and more conversations with whatever you want to know and whatever techniques that you use as well. But I think it'd be helpful for us to know who's in the room, so if you could just give us your name and your let's shape the conversation.
For this year's festival, I wrote Shelter in Place, which you can see at noon tomorrow. I'm also a sound and lighting designer.
I'm Jade Rosenberg, and I'm actually a PhD at the Playwrights Foundation.
Good morning.
So that our friends who are joining us on live stream actually have some idea what's going on?
Yes.
That would be great.
We are mostly playwrights in the room. But we have a couple of other, you know, skill sets in here as well.
So, as you all know, and I hope that you know by this by now, that a lot about building relationships. So, for those of you who submit and try to get productions and get productions, you're always building relationships with literary departments, with directors, with artistic directors all the time, producers, et cetera, et cetera. I hope you're doing that. That's how you're getting productions, right? Right, Alan?
Yes.
Right? Okay, right. But you know, one thing that I think a lot of theater artists and playwrights overlook is actually building a relationship with their audience. What is this audience, right? And I think it's easy to kind of overlook building that audience relationship, because sometimes we think of the audience as some kind of like mysterious, monolithic, they're the audience, they just, you know, they're people that go to the theater and you're not really sure who it is, and, you know, maybe a few of your friends and then everybody else. But you know, I think I've worked pretty hard sort of like identifying who my audience is over the past, 10, 15 years that I've been doing theater. And cultivating that audience relationship, I think, is just as important as cultivating relationships with producers and directors and artistic directors. And how do I do that? Let's talk about that a little bit. So a few years ago, I found this very interesting. Kevin Kelly, who was the founder of Wired Magazine, published this really viral article in I think, about 6 years ago? I think around 2008. And he popularized the idea of 1,000 true fans. Have you all heard of this concept? For any artist to survive and make it and actually make a living, what you really need, you don't need millions and millions of people to follow your work. All you really need, I mean, if you're kind of like an independent working artist, is 1,000 true fans to sustain a career over time. And so this thing that he wrote on his blog, I'll just quote for you. Quote, a creator such as an artist, musician, photographer, craftsperson define true fan. So now, in your own mind, I want you to start thinking of those people. How many true fans do you have, and how close are you getting to the 1,000? Now, the 1,000 is an inexact number, okay? It's a kind of rule of thumb. I don't think it's depressing at all, because I think it's I think having a goal to think about it is great, and 1,000 is really not that many. I mean, you know, how many Facebook friends do you have? Or, you know, you probably have close to that these days. You know. We're going to talk about cultivating. So for me, in my career, in kind of building my audience for my storytelling shows and for my multi-character plays, it's really not about quantity. It's really about quality of audiences. And I don't think fans are grab as many emails as possible to build a massive email list. I have them on Facebook and I'm on Twitter, and I'm not obsessed with trying to get as many followers as possible. I don't know if that's your perspective, coming from social media. I mean, is it a quality versus, where do you land on a quality versus quality?
It depends on how you define success.
Okay.
And it also depends on what you're talking about.
Okay, I'm talking about...
I'm saying on your social media.
Right. Like
what you're putting out there.
Yeah.
Would give me an idea of like how many people do I want this message to reach.
Right.
Do I want to talk about activating people to support the National Endowment for the Arts so I can get those grants? I want to reach as many people as possible. But is my reach only going to be effective if it's people who believe in me and believe in my product? Then I'm more about the quality than the quantity. Is it going to be people who are going to look for my posts, especially on a place like Facebook, whose algorithm shrinks the amount of people that you get, and they every time you start to figure it out, they change it? Then, yeah, I want people who are going to not only go hunt for my post,
right,
but they're going to then share my post with other people so I get the old organic reach that used to happen.
Right, right.
I don't know if everybody is familiar with this algorithm, but organic reach is the amount of people who just see by virtue of showing up in their feeds, not a paid post, it just gets there. And on Facebook specifically, if you have put a post out there and your friends, five of your friends, share that post, it has a much larger organic reach because it's hitting five people's 10%, which of their followers, of their friends.
Yeah, so I'm glad that you brought this up because Megan, when we were planning this, said, let's get a title for this workshop. And I pitched the title, Almost Nobody Sees Your Facebook Posts. And that's the title of this workshop. So and Susan and I never really actually talked about what that title meant to either of us. So I think this is what
it means. Truth.
Right. Yeah, right. I mean, it's when you how many of you are on Facebook? Everybody's on Facebook? Okay, yeah. So
that's how they found out about it.
Yeah.
They looked for us.
So when you post stuff on Facebook and you always like to have people like them, and then you post it and then like hardly anybody likes the thing that you posted, and then you feel horrible for the entire rest of the day, and just, enough of that ruins your life. And but the thing is that this organic reach thing is so infuriating, because it's not that people don't like your posts, it's because most of them aren't seeing most of them. Almost all of your friends are not seeing what you're posting.
Because one day you put up that picture of the cat and they got annoyed because they had seen too many pictures of the cat or your baby, or they changed your profile picture to not be you and they were like, hi. And then they don't see you again. Until Maricela tags you in a post and they see Maricela's post and they say, oh, I forgot about Susan. Oh, I have to figure out how to re-follow her. I have to redo this. And then somebody goes, oh, I just give up. But somebody might know Playwrights Foundation and say, hey, I saw those huge ads about the festival. I want to know the details of it. Oh, I'm too lazy to go to their website, but it's on Facebook. Okay, I know that they're there. Playwrights Foundation, easy, quick search. Oh, they have all these events. There's something on Saturday morning. I might be up. Okay, I'm here. Or they typed in Playwrights Foundation to a Google search, and boom, this event popped up because of this amazing thing called search engine optimization.
And we'll get into that. We'll get into the email list, but since we're on Facebook, so we'll get back to the email list and the community building itself. But, I'm interested in Facebook. I know a lot of theater artists, like the extent of their marketing in terms of like promoting shows that they really, really want people to come see. They'll create an event page on Facebook and then invite a ton of people, and then that's it. That's their thing. You know what? If I kind of know you, I'm probably at all because I've turned off that notification and I will visit and I turn off the notification thing. So I'll visit my event page like maybe once every 3 or 4 weeks, and then I'm like, oh, this is what's going on. So as much as I hate Facebook, you know, I guess I kind of love it also because I'm on it to do stuff and try to promote stuff and like that. So you actually have to have a broader kind of plan when you're on Facebook. So posting that event notice isn't enough. So what I did, I'll just use an example, like when the Bay Area Playwrights Festival was putting on the Brothers Paranormal, of course they had their own event page. I invited some people via Facebook I invited them to also kind of alerted people to it on various days that I wouldn't like do five posts on the same day or five days in a row. Like one week I would post a status update that was talking about something I was doing on the show. Another week I would actually post a photo, because you know the different types of things you post will also reach different people. So, you know, for example, photos will reach this group of people, but not this group of people. A status update will reach this group of people, but not this group of people. A link to something will reach this group of people, but not this group of people. So varying the stuff that you post on Facebook is very, very important. So you can't just like post status updates and expect everybody to see them. If that's what you're trying to do, if you want, you know, more than, how many percentage, 5, 10%?
Between 5 and 10.
If you want more than the 5 to 10% to know about the thing that you're doing, you're gonna have to post more than once, and then more than one different type of thing. Correct.
Correct. And in addition to that, when you're talking about photos, links versus just a plain old status update, even if it reaches people, they might just be scrolling. They're in line getting coffee, scrolling. But a photo's gonna pop to their eyes, and they're like, oh, that's really interesting. You have, it's called clickability. I think that a lot of people know about headlines and pull people in, clickbait, and things like that. You can think about your Facebook post as a little bit of click. You want it to be as clickbaitable as possible. That doesn't mean using a BuzzFeed title for it. It means
I hated this video for the first 38 seconds, but then it blew my mind. How can you not click that?
But, I mean, think about the ads that you see out around. Is it the one with the compelling image that you stop and read, or is it the one that's just a lot of words? Set up your posts in the same way. Add a link to something. A link to tickets or a link to your webpage, which we will get to, that tells information about an event. You want something, but you know what, it don't feel like well with, or I'm on my tablet, which doesn't have a great keyboard, I can't post it without a photo. Don't feel that way. I'd rather have you put something out there, just typed, without an image or a link, but when you have the time, add an image or a link. It will reach more people, and it will get more people to notice it.
But you know, your Facebook page is not just about kind of like promoting your shows. So if that's, because I know, maybe we know some people. I know some people where I swear to God, like the only posts I see are come to my show, give money to my Kickstarter campaign, Indiegogo, etc. And I shut that person on my side. You know, I can't. That's not, first of all, that's not the only thing that Facebook is for. And second of all, that's mostly what not Facebook is for. Facebook is for connecting you to your friends and just people working with me on Facebook. That's great, and then if you have a show up once in a while, sure. Kickstarter campaign, all right, I don't believe in it, but all right, everybody's doing it. I've given. I'll never ask you for money, but I've given.
I have a 50-40-10 rule for my businesses. Individuals are a little bit different. But for a business or a theater company or an event, 50% of your social media posts should be about the larger world, the larger scope. 40% should be selling tickets or selling your Kickstarter campaign or asking someone to come to a symposium. And 10% can be anything, absolutely anything. Because social media is not about marketing. Social media is about engagement. It's about engagement with the community. It's about sharing things with one another. It's why it is such a neat tool. Because instead of saying, hey, here's this print newspaper, I'm going to have to cut out an article and send it to my mom. I can send her a link, or I can tag people in a post, or I can tweet something out and get information out to a large group of people. What type of information I choose should be well thought of.
You know, I think for me, I think for individual audiences, I think the ratio should be 90-10. I think it's 90% you'd be a real human being on Facebook. That's what Facebook is for. And then 10%, okay, you can tell me, I will tell you about my show when it happens or my little workshop.
Can I ask a question about that?
Yeah.
I'm really curious. I grew up before the internet was popular. So I'm a little more cagey than I think some of my younger peers are about life. So everything I post is friends and friends only. Is that, and I know people, some friends of mine have like developed like a persona for their marketing on Facebook, like that's the public face and then their personal Facebook page is their, like what they think of the world, whatever. Do you have, what can you say about that aspect of Facebook?
Yeah, I mean, I have, for those of you who are friends with me on Facebook, might know that I have public posts and I also have friends and friends only posts. And then I also have different lists and I have people who I've restricted from seeing certain things, like my mom. You know, so yeah, I mean, I'm very careful as to, I'm very thoughtful when it comes to what I am posting. There is stuff that I think is in public, but there's also fun stuff like, you know, Aaron, you love my, you know, quotes from my mom, but
absolutely,
that's not for public consumption. That's just, you know, that's just...
I don't
just
know. I think you should...
Select people.
So wait, you have like a public... Okay, so do you know what all this is?
I probably don't have it. So.
Right, so you want to explain public...
Sure.
Okay.
First, I want to make a comment as a follow-up to Roberta's piece. Regardless of where you're putting it, if you're putting it on your blog, a website, on a social media page, you should not put anything out there that you wouldn't want, unless you're very careful about it, that you wouldn't want your mother, your boss, your future employer, or your lover to see. Because scraping the internet is really, I want to curse, really hard. I've had to do it for some clients, and it is not guaranteed. There are little fingers in the internet that will find the page, the post that you don't want anyone to see that you wanted to erase. So think before you tweet, Facebook page, publish. Because you might not be able to get rid of it no matter how much you want to. So that goes first. Two different pages, having like a business page and then your personal account page. There are some advantages to being a business, you know, whether it's your company or a playwright. You're able to schedule posts on Facebook in particular, schedule them in advance through their scheduler, which means that it reaches people organically in a better way. If you try to do it through an aggregator such as Hootsuite or something, Facebook hides those. So they developed a scheduling tool for businesses. It's really...
Facebook hides Hootsuite?
Yeah.
So it doesn't
work. For Facebook, yeah.
Sorry.
I'm talking about as a business.
Okay.
As individuals, I think that it shows up a little bit more, but it. But no, they developed a scheduling tool so that you would use their tool. On that note, please don't link your Twitter and your Facebook account. Please don't. You have two different audiences. People who are looking at you on Twitter and people who are looking at you at Facebook have different mindsets. And if they're looking at you at both, they want different information from you on each. Okay, so stop that. The advantage of having a public persona, treating yourself as a business versus your, hey, these are my friends from grammar school through university and my neighbor and my dog sitter and all.
So just to clarify, so you know that you see celebrity Facebook pages and stuff like that. So individuals can have their own kind of like public page that's separate from your private page.
To be used in a professional capacity.
Correct.
So Cheryl D. Huddleston, playwright. Correct. It's up to you if you want to publish things. If you want to create a different persona, that's a really great way to do it. If you feel like you're going to have people follow you, it's a great way to do it.
But here's the problem with that, though. Over the past year, the whole thing that Facebook has been doing with promoted posts has gone really good.
Yeah.
So I have a cat that's internet famous. His name is Porkchop. He has more friends than I do. So he has his own kind of like public page, right? And for the past, I don't know, like for the first 2, 3, 4 years that he had that page, anytime I posted a thing, like tons of people you could actually see how many people actually see your posts on those public pages. He would get tons of views. 6 months to a year, Facebook has really been pushing this thing called promoted posts, where you have to pay. So the more you pay, the more people will see your stuff. So I've noticed that over the 6 months to year period, anytime now that I post something on Porkchop's, the views have been cut dramatically because they want me to put in money in order
right.
for them to look at my cat phone. So I don't know how useful. I don't know.
It would be. It depends on what you want to put out there. It depends on whether you want to spend your time separating your public posts, which would be essentially your public persona, promoting your shows, talking about professional things, saying like, just finished the first draft of blah blah blah. So excited, celebrating with my time.
You just have
photo
to be
of
very,
my
you
time.
Just have to be very, you know, Mark Zuckerberg has a private page that public people that other people can follow. And anybody can do that. So there is an option in Facebook that you have
yes,
Facebook
they created page. That follow
you have
for
a
that reason.
You have a follow option.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's a lot of trouble. I run 14 Facebook pages. It takes a lot of coordination. It takes a lot of thinking sometimes. It's like from certain sites, you can't share to the, it's gotten better, but you can't share to the correct account, so you've got to go back and cut and paste and do that. Sometimes it's easier just to have one.
We could loop back around to Facebook in a little bit, but I kind of want to talk about Twitter a little bit because I am always on the verge of getting rid of my Twitter account.
Yeah.
And it's like I have a few hundred followers. I hardly ever use it. I mean, like I follow like 5 people. There's a few hundred people follow me, and I'm like, but there's a few hundred. I can't get rid of. I want to get rid of it. What? I don't like it. I don't.
This is my moment.
Okay.
This is my moment. How many people read a print newspaper? Handful. How many people read a newspaper online? How many people read their social media accounts? What? Many more.
How many of you have Twitter?
How many people know what my shirt is? How do you know what my shirt is?
Facebook,
social media,
all
three. That kid got into the newspapers because of social media. That kid is known because of hashtag that kid, hashtag SF that kid. That kid saves the world. People sharing in advance of that kid going out and saving Gotham, that is San Francisco, through the Make-A-Wish Foundation, Bay Area Make-A-Wish Foundation. It would never have made the nightly news. It would not have made the Chronicle. The Associated Press that is printed as the Chronicle. If it hadn't been for people pumping up this phenomenon before the day that Miles went out there and Miles, man, I'm donating to your fund. I don't do Kickstarter, but Indiegogo, okay. But this is social media was a great way to get a phenomenal story out. A story about a little human being who wanted to be a superhero. It was amazing to me to see the build-up to that day in San Francisco. This is why I'm on Twitter. Because it's a better news.
What if you're a non-phenomenal human being who just can't I'm on too many social media things. Like I'm on Facebook, I'm on Twitter, I'm on LinkedIn, I look at none of it, except Facebook, just because I don't know. It's fun, you know. Twitter is not fun. It's not fun for me.
I was a late adopter to Twitter.
Okay.
I was a doubter.
Okay.
I was a serious doubter.
But what was the thing that turned you around?
The thing that turned me around
what
is
Twitter
that.
What is Twitter for?
Twitter is for. Twitter I treat as a news feed. It's an actual news feed. They do not prevent me from seeing my followers from seeing me. It's. I might the things that were from a day ago. And if I know that there's a person who I find interesting, I can go to their direct feed and read all of their tweets back, you know, days and days, unless they're an obsessive tweeter.
Isn't the reach of Twitter even less than Facebook?
It depends on how often you check. It depends on how many people you follow. If you are selective about who you follow, you know, I follow like 700 different accounts, but not all of those 700 accounts tweet all the time. But if I want to know why my lights go out, I follow PG&E. They're going to tell me there's an outage in this area. We'll let you know when it's coming up. Expected 4 hours. I don't have to go hunt anywhere for it. It's right there. It's in my feed. It's an interesting, quick conversation I can look through really quickly and get in a short amount of verbiage what somebody's trying to tell me.
Okay,
if I want to link to something else, it's there.
Okay.
Well, earlier, Prince, you were talking about how there's not a relationship.
Right.
For me, Twitter is about building relationships and across the country. The reason why I'm absolutely about her, I joined it because it was really passionate. We are community that's online.
Right.
And I've developed, and it's led to membership in Chicago, relationships across the country, in D.C., and in L.A. It's been better for my career than anything else. Because being on Twitter and getting to know the people that are there, because you build relationships, and then someone like, you mentioned this play in your last week. I want to read it.
Yeah.
So, and so for me, if you're on it more, you can see what they're talking about. There's a lot of theater conversation. When you kind of step into the fan, when you're in the theater world, I see it first on Twitter.
Yeah.
Way in advance before I ever see it on Facebook, or even doing what I do. Always on Twitter first.
And people are trying to converse. I mean, it is difficult in 140 characters or less to have the kind of conversation that you can have when you're on the phone with someone or in a room. But there are some really nice conversations that happen about the state of theater, the state of the arts, playwriting problems. There are a lot of playwrights on Twitter, and they're active. And I've heard from a lot of different playwrights, both here in the Bay Area and ones that I have met just by being on hashtag 2AMT, hashtag New Play. Those are the large ones. New Play is curated by HowlRound. If anybody doesn't read HowlRound, you should. It's a great source of information about theater.
Hi, HowlRound!
Yay! That playwriting being such an individual task for a large portion of the development of your play is a way to talk to other people across your discipline. I mean, we're lucky in the Bay Area, there are a lot of playwrights, but there are playwrights who are in every city in America and don't get to get together with people and have writing groups necessarily, who don't know someone else who's going through the same, you know, block or issue. And so they come to Twitter and talk things out. Yes?
So I have Twitter account, but I have never used it. I use Facebook. And I think the thing that prevents me, like, mentally from starting, so I'm like, I don't know what I would say, because I don't, like, have following at it. And so would you recommend, like, going to some of these, like New Play hashtags, which, like, see, like, listening first, kind of? Like, you walk in a room, like, there's a big room, and listen to people are talking about, and see if that, like, sparks something that you might want to contribute to? Because that seems like, I feel like I'm in a room shouting out to people, and I don't know.
Yes, I do. I the one thing that is problematic about Twitter is the time, because so much it is in real time.
Yeah.
If you did something an hour ago, people are probably not going to see it. Another rule of thumb, Facebook versus Twitter, is post one thing on Facebook a day, unless it's really, really interesting to get a second one out there. You could tweet, you could do 1,000 tweets a day, and it would be okay, and people on Twitter would not get angry at you, unless you're spammy. No, but if it's about different content, that would be fine. There's no rule on Twitter. And Twitter actually won't let you post the same thing twice. It will refuse your tweet. So you have to vary it. Even if you're tweeting about the same thing, you have to vary it in order for it to go out. Vary it in order for it to go out. One thing that I highly recommend is the weekly Thursday New Play chat. It's a great way to meet via Twitter other theater makers around, at this point, around the world. We do have some people in the UK who are active at this point. And you might find some people who whose conversation is interesting and you want to follow up with. I had a session with someone who's in Kentucky yesterday because he's trying to do some of what I do. He's also an actor and he's trying to build a little side gig. We had a Skype conversation yesterday because he saw some posts that I had made on a new play chat recently. It's like, I'm interested in what you have to say. We have a chat. It's great. And then he cried. I followed him. Yes.
I want to go back to the back kid thing for a minute. Because I read something on Slate a few weeks ago that said all this stuff about things going viral is actually like you're fooling yourself. Like things that go viral are actually not planted, like fake planted, but placed by people who are already influenced. So I'm curious about that kid, which is the same kind of phenomena on social media, that like a few very influential people got the word out and that's how the news picked up versus somebody who worked for Make-A-Wish posting. Do you have any like a difference? And does that matter? Like, how do you get something to genuinely, if you don't at that 1,000 fan point yet, how do you help your life or your work go viral in a way that's potentially organic?
If you're engaging with other people, it will happen. But you have to be committed to engaging. Yes, the Make-A-Wish Foundation has a press representative and put this out, but there are tons of things that PR reps put out and nobody cares about.
It really depends on what you're talking about, too.
Right.
I mean, it's like you know, you can do something that goes viral. You're not going to be able to monetize it or make a living at it. I mean, so it's like, what is the point of what you're doing? So I have another question for you, but I want to.
Yeah, we had a question.
But I want to take, yes, a few questions more about Facebook and Twitter, and then I have some other.
I agree absolutely about Twitter. Somebody was saying that they got a really, really good connection. Well, I'm very, very interested in having my work produced in the UK. And through Twitter, not only do I have new followers that I didn't seek, but that I have somebody who's now reading my play, who I do not know because of Twitter. And for me, Facebook has kind of faded in the background. Because the last 3 or 4 months, I have become this intensive social media person. Well, I never thought I would be too many years that I had come back. But the other thing I just wanted to mention briefly was that I think for playwrights, I think psychologically, at least this is how I feel about myself, it is difficult for me to market myself. It is difficult for me to sell my plays. It is much easier for me to do it on social media, but even saying that, I think I have to kind of continually press myself forward to say things on Twitter about my own work. And I think for me, it's an interesting different persona. I have to be somebody else other than the person who sits and writes buffalo books. I have to be.
You have to wear a different hat.
I actually want to address this because this is like one of the first points I actually wanted to make, but you didn't really talk about yet. I think some of the language, you know, the sort of like the playwright self-promotion thing, I think it would be helpful for us to change some of the language around that. I think for theater in general, because I don't know how many times you get emails from theaters or emails from your friends who are like, hey, I'm in the show, please come support me. Please come support theater. It'd be great if... Like you're some kind of charity case that you're begging to be seen.
Right.
But if you're creating something of quality, and I hope that you are, then you should be able to speak about it in a way where you're exciting people. I mean, I think one of my strengths as a promoter is that I know how to get people excited about the thing that I'm doing. But I can only get people excited about the thing that I'm doing is because I have extreme confidence in the thing that I'm doing. I know a lot of people who are like, you know, they just finished the first draft of a play, barely a first draft of a play. They have a meeting, and it's like, hey, if you have time, come and maybe kind of give me feedback on this thing. It's a little bit rough, but you know, I don't have time. I don't have time.
Prince does not do that. Prince is like, this is the best play you've ever seen.
And am I right?
Yeah, you're right.
I have this when I teach down at USC, I have this rule right before we do feedback sessions on people's work. What we do is we workshop plays and scripts in class, and before people read them out loud, a lot of the time students will apologize for the work before it's time. Have you been in this workshop where it's like, okay, it's your turn, and then the student will go, oh, great, I just wanted to let you know I this is really rough, and you know, I know that the thing in the middle is up. And my number one rule during workshopping is you cannot apologize for your work. And I feel like I see a lot of people apologizing for the work. And how are you going to promote your work and get people to come see your work and get people excited about your work if you're always apologizing in subtle and not so subtle ways? But it's usually very subtle ways. It's like, hey, if you have time, come. I don't have time. Nobody has time. Get me excited about it. I'll make the time.
Pull a really great quote. There's always something I really love. Pull a quote. Yes. Take a picture of it. Use the script. Quote that. Put that out there. There's a thread that you're putting you really love. Someone out there will too love that really quick. Basically, you can share it. It's 140 characters. Put it on Twitter. It's like retweet. You have multiple accounts. You can retweet multiple accounts. That's not.
Can you say that loud? I can't hear that. Oh, here's front of the camera. Can't you say it loud?
Someone else will love what you love about your play. Pull a quote. Take a picture of the script. It will compel them to come and see it. If you have multiple accounts, retweet from those accounts. Ask your friends to retweet. Reach out to people, because other people will get excited about your work when you are excited about your work. I thoroughly.
And I read other tweets, and I get ideas about marketing. Really good organizations and really huge theaters. I do that. I absolutely listen to their language, and that's what helped me see that I was starting to be subtly these. Go the other direction,
right.
Which is not easy for a playwright. We're introverted folks, you know. I mean, it's not an easy thing.
Yeah, but you know, it's not an easy thing, but it can be learned. I perform, I teach. Believe it or not, I'm one of the biggest introverts on the planet. But it's a thing that you learn. There are lots of books that you can pick up in terms of kind of like figuring out how to get out of that shell. Right?
Oh no, absolutely.
Yeah.
So, at Spreeders, P.S. at Spreeders. Please give your handle if you have one.
So, I love social media. I love Twitter. I love not so much Facebook, but especially Twitter. And for a while, I had my own blog, which I want to go back to that long before kind of writing about what kind of work. But my enthusiasm for Twitter and Facebook and actually email and everything that's on YouTube because of the stroke and the NSA. My enthusiasm for those forms of media, including my own email, have gone down the tubes with the whole NSA stroke sort of revelation. I prefer being in public space with people now. It's really altered that. And I'm still trying to work through how I feel about that. Because it did, being on Twitter, especially, really helped me connect with other playwrights across the world.
So I thought I'd say hi to the NSA anytime you send an email. That's the best way.
Yeah.
Let's take a few more questions about that.
Yeah.
I personally feel, and Susan might disagree, I feel like you could drop the Twitter and you could drop the Facebook, but you can't drop email. I feel like email lists are the most valuable player in terms of reaching people. If we're talking about getting people to come to your shows, I don't know that Facebook and I think that I can get rid of my Facebook. I think I can stop going on Facebook and Twitter and still get people to go to my shows just through via email. Because I know my audience. I know who they are. I collect emails through at my shows, through my website, from my blog. And that's a valuable thing. You know, remember when MySpace was the thing and you were collecting friends and fans on MySpace? And then, you know, yeah, sure, it looks like Facebook and Twitter are going to be around for a long time, but I don't know. I know that email's not going anywhere.
All of your time, instead of writing your plays and having your life, you will spend all your time trying to build these relationships on various platforms. I'm not an Instagrammer. I never have been. I run it for other people, their accounts, but it's not my thing. That's okay. I'm a Twitter person. I like that. I'm on Facebook because I've been on it for so long. I like that. I have Pinterest. I use Pinterest as a tool for dramaturgy for shows that I'm working on because it's a great visual source for me, and I can share those images with other people, with my director, with a designer can share with me. I find that useful. Lauren asked us to pass this on. She loves Tumblr. That's her thing. She sets up a Tumblr for every one of her plays while she's writing. Source of information about what she's putting, both using a tool for herself, and it turns into a marketing tool. When people produce her plays anywhere around the world, they can go to her Tumblr and say, that was her intent for this piece because she's written about it, she has it out there in the public sphere. But she loves Tumblr. I'm not so great on Tumblr. You need to pick the things that are going to work for you, enrich your life as an artist, and make you comfortable.
I totally agree.
You totally agree.
I'm getting rid of my
thing that I argue against on getting rid of things that you've already been active in or that might be interesting to you is the possibility that it helps you when somebody searches for your name if they don't know you already. It's reasons to get you. It raises your results. If they look you up and add Playwright to you, that helps too. You know, they're in Bing or Google or if there are any other search engines anymore.
Oh, we should talk about websites.
But also, there are theaters who like to promote you on all of these things, and if you have an account, they like to link to you. And that can help, especially if you're not produced as widely as some people here are. It might help. They might be able to find your persona and say, oh, okay, that's what this person is about. Their play might get picked in this other play. I don't know. It seems that people who are getting produced a lot have some presence out there. And some people have none. So it's all a crapshoot. It's like getting into university. Why anybody gets in or doesn't. But I do think that having some kind of web presence in this century is a good idea.
All right, I'm keeping my Facebook. I'm getting rid of my LinkedIn. And I'm getting rid of my Twitter. So you can't find me on there after today. But I think the email list is important. But I also think website is very good as well. And I think that's that. I think that's far more important than Facebook or Twitter.
Absolutely, absolutely. You need a place. If it's just a landing page with a way for people to contact you, you need a way for people to find out how to contact you. And you need it in a way that if they type your name in a search engine, they're going to find you. A company that's doing readings of yours can link to it. So people who might come and see your reading or your production can say, what's this playwright about? Who is this person? Where can I learn more about you? I really like that.
How do I find out about what else they're doing? Mm-hmm. I go to that company's website, who I went to the reading for, and find out more about your playwright, about the playwright that they produce. So it's not only that you're using yourself, but allowing us as a theater company to help promote you maybe indirectly in a way, post, pre, and during the production, or meeting, or show, or workshop.
People do that. They do say, oh, I saw Don's play. That was really great. I want to know more about his work. Well, every theater company that does a reading or production of your show is not going to be able to give a full in-depth bio about what this list of plays you've written are, but your website can. And it's also going to tell your agent's information or whoever, your manager's information or your information, some way to say, I want to do this play. I want to do his play. Oh, Beth's stuff was really great. Like, that was so interesting. I love website. Okay, I can find all this information. But, oh, she does that too? Oh, fabulous.
I get a lot of emails from people through my website.
Do you respond?
I do. I respond to every email. Unless it's... Well, I even respond to the green.
it's the best way. It's like, it's the new business card.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not so new, but I still think you should have business cards because there are some people who you'd be looking at and you meet on the street. It's great, and it should have your web page out there, obviously, and any other information you're willing to give out. I don't always do phone numbers. But it's a way to control how people contact you, too. You can... When it comes through your web page, you can have it set up so you know that it came from the web page, and this is the way somebody contacted me, this is how they found me. Oh, it's a nice filter. And it creates that public persona that's separate from your personal persona. Instead of somebody saying like, oh, this is Prince's Facebook page and the cat, et cetera, et cetera. It's like, this is what he does for a living. This is his background. This is his CV. This is where he's been produced. This is what he has coming up next. But on a web page, the important thing is to be able to update it yourself. Because paying someone else to do that is very costly.
So I use Wix.com and Wix.com. Very easy interface, very, very easy to put together on a really, really good looking website.
It depends on what drives you. If words drive you or if images drive you. You should do test trials on different platforms and see what's easier for you to work on. Squarespace is fabulous for a lot of people. It's very visually oriented. With, you know, drag and drop. WordPress is much easier for putting content in and for being able to control the HTML content, even for someone who just gets an HTML for Dummies book. But it's not as visually pleasing in a lot of ways, and there are thousands of themes to choose from. That can be difficult. Weebly is another one that some people use in addition to Wix. A little bit easier interface, but not as much customization. So you need to think about what kind of web page you want, what's important to get out there. And if you need help, seek out someone like me who works on all of the platforms and have a session to figure out, like, hey, what am I looking for and what's the best way to do this? Or set something up for me and then teach me how to update it. You want to be able to update it because your information should be current and hopefully your work is continuing to grow. And you want to put that information out there.
Yeah, you know, it really depends on what your objectives are. You know, is it about kind of reaching out to theaters and connecting with other playwrights across the country? Is it about getting people to come to your shows? San Francisco Bay Area, in LA. What is it? So what is that objective? I'm reading this great book called Essentialism, the Disciplined Pursuit of Less, which talks about goal setting and really kind of figuring out what you want in your career, in different aspects of your life, and basically cutting out anything that does not support that goal. And there's a great quote in it. I forget the name of the author, but he quotes somebody else. And the quote is, you can never overestimate the unimportance of almost everything. And it's true. I mean, if you think about your life and what's not essential, it'll blow your mind. And which brings me back to this getting rid of the Twitter or LinkedIn thing. It's like I feel like it's not essential for me.
I think for me, my problem with social media is every time I'm about to post something, I have that same thought. I'm like, I really need to do this, and I believe it, you know. And so in the last 24 hours, I was doing experiments, just having to write something on Facebook, respond to something on Twitter, or just spontaneously self-censoring. And I just can't find a balance, because I feel virtually anything I put out, I want to do that. Is that adding? I'm not sure how to find a balance.
Right. I think it takes a bit of soul searching to kind of figure out what that balance is.
And there's been a lot of discussion about moods and how social media affects moods. Feeling good about yourself and feeling bad about yourself. If something makes you feel bad about yourself, don't do it. You know, don't read about your ex from high school's beautiful new career, family, blah, 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 because you know what? That's not going to make you feel good. If it makes you feel good, then read it. It's amazing what this new connection you were not connected with in the traditional sense has done to the psyche. And if it's not good for you, get out of there. But you need to have something online, so have a website. If you have nothing else, have a website.
So people can find you.
So your audience can find you.
Yes.
So
yes.
Theater companies can find you. So individual artists can find you. And spread the good word of your work.
Is there anything else that you want to us to elaborate upon? Or is there anything we haven't touched? What do you want to discuss?
Yeah. Also with your email list, do you run it through like a MailChimp?
No, I run it through a service. I run it through your mailing list provider. But for people that I know will come to my shows, if I'm doing one, I'll email them individually.
Just different
places.
Yeah. Providers out there. I test them out, see what one you're comfortable with. When you set up your template, which is a great idea, so people see some type of signature from you, whether you started the same way or you have a beautiful background, whatever it is, you need to test it on different servers. You need to test it to different email addresses. Set up false email addresses. If 50% of the people on your email address are on Gmail, and another 25% are on Hotmail, and another 3% are on Yahoo, don't optimize that email for Yahoo, because it's going to show up completely differently for the people in Gmail. You need to think about the way you're reaching your audience, not just the people and the content you put in there, but what they're going to see. And then you have to check it on a mobile, too. People check the vast majority of their email and see these days on mobile. And if you have this beautiful image, like a great graphic for your new play, and it's taking up all the mobile space and it's not going to load, people aren't going to read all of the wonderful content that you spent time testing. So commit the time to setting up your email newsletter or just the email announcing something. Take the time to set it up. Check it on different accounts. Check it in different browsers, because it also shows up differently that way. And once you think you've finished it, shut it down, walk away for a half hour or an hour, and come back and look at it. It's guaranteed you have a spelling mistake, or one of your links doesn't work, and you need to stop your brain, go away, do something else, come back and look at it. I absolutely cannot stand when somebody sends me a corrected email newsletter later. I say, screw it, I'm not great. Like, you didn't spend the time to fix it in the first place. I'm not interested. I get way too much stuff in my inbox. You want it to go out right the first time.
We are so angry up here.
It is so early.
We are so angry. Elizabeth.
One of the things you mentioned
early
on
is
searching
for competition.
Speak up a little bit.
So the question is about search engine optimization, also known as SEO.
So SEO is how search engines, such as Google and Bing, provide their results. Sites that are optimized, that have keywords, that have content, that have new content, that have been around for a certain amount of time, show up higher in a feed. That's something that is brand new, only has images, doesn't have any keywords. If you're, and depending on how you're setting up your web page, you program those things in differently. There are widgets to help you with, there are people to help you with, companies, large companies like OpenTable, Coca-Cola, GE, pay people a lot of money to optimize their search engine, The Gap. Anybody who's selling something spends a lot of time on SEO. SEO is in the middle of a change right now. Google's saying that they're going to not use it as much. We're not quite sure what's happening, but it's still relevant as of today. So that's something we can talk about a little bit offline if you totally don't understand it. But there are also some great like little tutorials online if you have a web page or a blog site, Google, SEO, and that, whatever that service is, and you can watch tutorials on like how to optimize your site. It's very helpful. Because it's gonna help people when they look for you, find the, not just like, e-hunter screen, okay, that's on Playwrights Foundation. What you want is your site to be first.
Translating like who I am. Let's say she's having a meeting with her artist and we're like merging, figuring out like what I'm interested in. I know what I'm interested in, but like getting more towards like how am I presenting myself as an artist in the world, both in the real world but also online. So if you have like for your clients, they say, I don't know if most like what should I be talking about? Are there like questions that you sort of have in the back of my mind? Like is this about my values? Is this about family dressing? Like what kinds of things that would like, help me get started?
What are the kinds of things that you want to reach people with? Do you want to, is it a topic that's driving you? Is it something that just happened on the street? Is it a conversation that you had? Developing your persona is something that I think is difficult for all artists.
I think it's a lifelong process, yeah. But I feel like your public persona is just an extension of yourself, a little bit more amplified.
So it's like, is it also, because you're a playwright.
Playwright, but also, I make work.
Okay, well, think about the type of plays you're writing or the type of work that you're devising. What you want to project out there about that work. Is it esoteric? Is it like straight living room drama? What is the vocabulary of your work? And go from there. Because the vocabulary of your work should be linked to the vocabulary of yourself.
A tool that I find really useful when I'm figuring out what I want to post is what do I want to remember? Because oftentimes when I look at my Twitter, it's about reading something or talking to someone. I post things that I've heard that I want to go back to later. Because as Susan said, it is very difficult to scrub the internet and remove things. And just as difficult as it is, there. So if you're just tweeting and you don't know like who to talk to, just read a book or you're walking the streets and picture that you really like, just post it. Because chances are maybe it'll be inspiration for you later for a piece. Or like as Lauren Gunnarsson does from her Tumblr, she uses that as she's writing her play, because it helps her keep information in one space. Doing that with the social media tool is helpful because then you can go back and say, why did I post that picture? Why was that quote so important to me? Or how did that help me at this point? Find it. So
it's kind of one of those things too, because also if you go back, it's weird, you can go back years if you've been between for however long, you can see you were talking about it 3 years ago, and you say, wow, I was really obsessed with creating the first bird or something at that moment in my life. I don't know why, I was so obsessed with trees. Maybe I was going on a trip to Seattle and I wanted to figure out, but there's something, so it's kind of nice if you don't know what to talk about, just talk about what you want to remember, and then that's an equation for it, just talk about what you want to remember, and you can figure out what you want to learn about, and keep sharing that.
There are some sites that explain hashtags that
explain kind of ways to tweet. I can send you something. I can send you a little cheat sheet. But Twitter themselves, at least they used to, it's been years since I've been on it, had kind of a guide to using Twitter.
I haven't seen one. They still have it because I started on Twitter a couple months ago.
And it, there are some quick things, like if you're on Twitter and you start a tweet with someone else's handle, which is what the @ and then their Twitter name, they're going to see it, and the people that follow both of you are going to see it, but nobody else is. If you put a period before it and put the @ and their handle, then everyone who follows you is going to see it. Yeah.
There's a great book called The Zen of Social Media Marketing, which might like.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sending out, of course, pretty query letters to people that I have prior relationships with at certain theaters. Of course, I meet people at conferences, at events, and sometimes I'll just reach out to people that I'm interested in getting to know. So I don't use any of that social media stuff for that at all.
And that is fine. That is fine. I think it's great to develop that personal connection, because lit managers, artistic directors get so many queries that to have a personal connection with someone, even inviting them to see your other work, letting them know what is new in your life.
Well, you know, I run up down in LA. I have a standing playwrights and literary managers poker night. that happens a few times every year. And it's not for me to get my work up, because like as I mentioned yesterday, I like write one play every 5 or 6 years. So it's not about that. It really is about creating this community of people that you're genuinely interested in and you want to play poker with and take the money.
Nice. What would you say to someone is the most important thing about
I think the most important thing is to actually know the theater company very well, like know their work. So, if you're in the Bay Area and you're sending out queries or trying to get people to read your work at Working Rep or wherever, Ultra Theater or Central Works or whatever, it's, I think, the number one thing that needs to happen is that you have to be intimately familiar with the kind of work they do and who the main players are. And, to really be connected to that theater, at least on that audience level first, before making first contact.
Do you guys have any other questions about this area? I mean, I don't know what stages people are at it. It depends on who's running their account. I know who runs the account for some theater companies, because it is very clear in the description of their staff who is. Whether or not they're passing that information to lit managers and ADs, I think that varies by company. Certainly the smaller companies, the people who have the power to produce are paying attention, because they may be running them themselves.
Just to speak to that a little bit, because I'm a literary manager for Playhouse. For me, you know, I'll hear about a play and want to, find out how can I contact the playwright, how can I find their agent. And I will, like, my biggest tool is using Google, doing a Google search. And when playwrights have websites, like, just to echo that, it's the greatest thing ever. When their website is there, it has either their agent's contact information or it has how to contact them, and I can easily reach out and ask to see their play. When it takes me searching through multiple pages on Google to find someone's information, I'll just give up, to be quite honest. It's like, I don't have all the time in the world to really be looking and hunting someone down, so I can definitely...
I just remembered you emailed me for my script.
I did.
Did you like it?
I loved it.
Thank you.
That's how, at least for me, a tool is finding people, because you hear about a play, you want to read it, but if you can't contact them, it's just, I don't have an hour to find your play. So I just want to echo, websites, amazing, work on your Facebook page. I know you don't want to have your email necessarily public, but just having some way that I can contact you, because I don't really feel comfortable contacting people through Facebook. I feel a little sketchy about it. Asking for their play personally.
And also, people who send you messages via Facebook and they're not your friend goes into a separate folder that you may never see.
Never chat. Yeah.
Like once every 6 months, I'll be like, oh, who wrote me in the other folder?
It's called other.
You don't even see it.
Yeah.
It's really.
I can't even tell you
where it is right now. Yeah. I don't even remember where it is.
So when you go to messages, there are two tabs.
If you're checking on your mobile, it's probably harder to find. Thank you. Thank you for telling people that what we're telling them is right. That's exactly what we wanted. on your website to have, if you're going to do an email list, which I think if you're not convinced by prints, you're never going to be. There's usually a widget that you can program into a website pretty easily. In addition, in an email signature, your upcoming events, so that when you email people out, there's stuff at the bottom that says, like, this is my, you know, just a signature is very easy to set up, and your web page should be there.
I personally have to disagree. I personally don't believe in that. I feel like people try to sell me.
You don't think that putting like info@prince.com?
You mean like if somebody's contacting you via email and I'm replying?
Yes.
No.
No.
Okay.
Okay. No, I mean that. I
That's the only thing we've disagreed on.
That's okay.
Right. I mean, I put my mission statement on my emails, and I've gotten more positive responses than I ever did when I put like my website or anything. People will often comment back, and I'm not expecting. Wow, that's great that you have that. So even if it's not your contact information, I find people thinking about you as a playwright, as an artist. My mission statement is to create beautiful work across the world, and I can't tell you how many people I don't know that I reach out to.
So if you're comfortable with it,
we've also got three tomorrow. So we are trying to support playwrights in any way we can. That includes classes like this. It includes helping develop their work. We've got five. Opportunities for you to support and see each other's work. Support, okay, I'm not saying support. See the awesome work that they're doing. We chose these plays out of, you know, 500. But also to see how those plays are talking to each other, and they will no doubt be talking to your own work as well. So do come and see them. It is cheaper if you buy a festival pass or a flex pass. But also don't miss the rest of the conversations. They are also fascinating. Yesterday we talked about writing for the now. How do you write about things that are happening immediately right now? How do you give them to stage before they go stale? Later this afternoon we're talking about how playwrights write about difficult topics, unpleasant things that people want to talk about at the dinner table. Something that is meaningful. We have two plays and we have a talk on deaf artists and roles that are written for and about them, but also just casting them in the show or using them as your director or your playwright or your dramaturg. How and why. So come be part of that conversation.
Thanks, Sarah.
Enjoy. Tomorrow we'll have pizza. So, more pizza.